Thank you very much, Andres, for joining me today to talk about your research. I've just got a few questions for you. The first one is about the fact that in your research project, you explore rates of autism diagnosis using data on all of the schools in the UK. What did you think you would find when you started the project?
I mean, this started like a very different project in a way. I mean, we knew that there was a very rich data set of you know, the school census available in the Department of Education. And I was coming from, I'm not coming from the autism community. My PhD was actually in psychosis. So one of the things that took some time to get a hold of as a concept was the fact that ethnic minorities, specifically people from British Asian minority ethnic groups, had a much higher incidence of psychosis. And this being a neurodevelopmental disorder led me to question, well, what's going on with autism? So I was really interested in kind of replicating that finding in a different group of patients, in this case autism, and the implications that this might have for the way that we see autism. You know, there's been a lot of discussions about it being relatively stable across and ethnic boundaries. And then came this other idea where it was, well, I don't really want like a global, you know, figure. I wanted to look at local geographies. And that's that one thing led to the other. And I ended up doing this project.
Thank you very much. And it's a lot of data. And it's a very complex analysis to do. So when you carried out your analysis, what did you find in the data?
So, I mean, we found quite a few different things. So the first was that there's a wealth of data, including more than 7 million children between the ages of 5 and 19. And we divided that into three different aspects of the data. One is the sociodemographic. So that is linked to ethnicity, of course, and social deprivation measured as membership or participation or what we call claim eligibility for the free school meals program. And then, of course, we also had sex. I mean, gender is also an important variable that we also wanted to look at. And then, of course, what we call the service provision variable. So children that are receiving autism-specific support in English schools, and then, of course, children that have a EHCP statement, and then the relation between one and the other. I mean, that's also something that we are quite interested in. And then we were able to map that according to local authorities, and the reason why we did that is because the provision of educational services, of course, is dependent on local authorities rather than NHS Trust. So we had a lot of discussions about if we included, you know, also the membership to NHS Trust and what that could imply for our data. But it's not that straightforward. And that is answering a slightly different question, I guess.
So what did you, so you were looking at gender, you were looking at ethnicity, and you were looking at the geographical distribution. So what were the key patterns that you found?
So the first thing is that this idea that autism is stable across ethnic boundaries is not the case. I mean, that's a very important finding. It's also a finding that I try to raise not from the perspective of many autism researchers, which are very focused on trying to find a cause or trying to find a biological explanation of what autism is, but rather about, well, you know, a service perspective. So who are the people that end up accessing this type of service, which is a slightly different question. I mean, it might be, for example, that people that are from Black and Asian minority ethnicities, British ethnicities, you know, they might be experimenting access barriers, or they might be referred more than, let's say, British white children of the same characteristics. So that's a finding in itself that needs further research, because we need to find out, well, is there actually a specific issue here at play? Like, for example, I was mentioning in psychosis, that neurodevelopment plays up differently in people from certain ethnicities. For example, in the case of psychosis, it was immigration that was deemed to be a determinant factor. Then the other thing is that there's huge variability among among local authorities. Some local authorities very much underperforming. I think it's appalling to see that in some cases girls are 13 times less likely to get a diagnosis than a boy. I think that's not what we will expect from local authorities. And I think that mapping of the male to female ratios across England was very, very telling. And I think that's something that also requires further analysis. And then the other thing is that the other idea that prevalence rates are stable across different geographies is also not the case. And we need to really look at what might be driving specifically higher prevalence rates in these type of areas. And that is also thinking of, for example, there's a lot of discussions about the systemizing theory of autism, in which we kind of tend to see that areas with higher amount of STEM occupations might have a higher amount of people with autism. So we're trying to continue working on this with this type of data and try to answer these questions in a parsimonious way, trying to explain this variability across these different lines. The other thing that I found and very important also to raise is the links between deprivation and autism as well. I mean, that means that it's not clear if parents with an autistic child come from poorer backgrounds, or if autism actually produces loss of income and therefore can be linked as well to social deprivation. So it's again a really important question, and I think people with autistic children, of course, will be very keen for that to be found out.
Thank you, Andres. So you've explained there sort of a lot of the information that's come out of this study that tells us more about the patterns of prevalence across the country and between groups, and also all of the really important questions that it raises that need further exploration. Can you just finish off by telling me what's next for your study?
So, well, there's a few things. So we're doing a couple of things with the study. As I mentioned, systemizing is going to be really important. And we're going to do also longitudinal modeling. And that means that we're going to be able to prove causation. So in causation means that we're going to be able to say that actually being from an ethnic minority background in Britain makes you more likely and can, you know, precisely cause, not necessarily the biological definition of autism, but makes you more likely to get a diagnosis in an EHCP. And then the other thing is we're going to look at modeling this across Britain in the in the fashion of trying to look at clusters where prevalence might be higher, as we described in this paper.
Thank you so much, Andres, for sharing these insights into your work today.
Mm-hmm. No worries. Thank you very much.